Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of the Health and Sport Committee in 2021. We have received apologies this morning from Alex Cole-Hamilton. Can I ask all members and witnesses please to ensure that mobile phones are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is an evidence session as part of our ongoing scrutiny of health boards and special health boards. And today we will hear from NHS Highland, and I welcome to the committee Professor Boyd Robertson, Chair Pam Dudek, Chief Executive David Garden, Director of Finance, and Dr. Tim Allison, Director of Public Health at NHS Highland. Welcome to you all to our meeting this morning, and we will move directly to questions, and I'll start by asking a bit about the impact of COVID on the ongoing challenges which you and other health boards face. I wonder if I may start by asking what role the board has had in managing localised outbreaks of COVID-19, including track and trace. And I'll come to you, Professor Robertson, as chair. Clearly, if you want to bring in a colleague, then please do so. Boyd Robertson.
Martin Va, good morning. And I'll bring in my colleague Pam Dudek, the new Chief Executive, shortly. But we've had, as you can imagine, a very challenging and very demanding year dealing with COVID over and above all the other items on our transformation agenda. And we have coped very well with the COVID pandemic. We put a command structure in place very early on in the pandemic, a gold, silver, and bronze command structure, which Pam Dudek will elaborate on, and that has enabled us operationally to handle the challenges very effectively. We have had outbreaks, as you're aware, in Home Farm and Portree early on in May of last year, a very difficult, traumatic experience for the community in Skye. And we have had more recent outbreaks as well in care homes in Easter Ross. But and in terms of the board's response, we have responded by having increased activity in terms of meetings. We have instituted chairs meetings, and also we have a weekly meeting of myself as chair, my vice chair, the CEO and the deputy CEO, to keep on top of what's happening, and the operational arm, they have daily huddles. But I'll hand over now to Pam to elaborate on that.
Pam.
Good morning. So I joined the organisation, as many of you will know, in April last year as the Deputy Chief Exec, so came in the middle of the response really being established. And Gold, Silver, Bronze Command, which is a standard way of working in an incident management context, was well developed at that point. And we've continued to use that, flexing it in accordance with where we're at in the COVID journey. I suppose I would sum up, and I will ask again Tim to maybe talk a bit more detail about how we've managed outbreaks and what we've seen. But we have really had strong surveillance through our data available to us on a regular base structure to manage the information that we have. We've worked collaboratively with those involved, wherever that is, wherever there's been an outbreak. And we've tried to ensure that our communication is good, although that's always an area of contention, I think, for most people. So like other boards, we have stood up in the way you would expect. It is unusual to use Gold, Silver, Bronze Command in a sustained incident like this, so we have had to learn how to do that. I think Tim would be good to talk about the actual outbreak management.
I'll call Tim Allison in a moment. Can I also ask Tim, while you have the floor, if you could give us some indication of your plans going forward in the event of further outbreaks of COVID? Tim Allison.
Thank you very much, convener. I joined the organisation like Pam in the middle of the pandemic at the start of July, and what I have seen is a good and efficient handling of outbreaks and of cases. We've been fortunate across NHS Highland to have relatively lower rates of COVID for most of the time compared with the rest of Scotland. But we have had, as the chairman has mentioned, had some serious outbreaks, particularly in care homes. You asked about our track and trace procedures. They have worked well, I think, helped by the lower level of cases. We have needed on occasion to health boards and nationally, and also on other occasions, we've been able to offer mutual aid. One thing that we've been able to maintain for longer than many other places is phone contact with the contacts of cases, not just the index cases. We haven't been able to do that all the time, and we haven't got that running at this very moment because of the high number of cases following on from Christmas. But that's given us an idea, a much better idea about the nature of cases, and to get to the bottom of the contacts and do a bit of the back tracing to get overall control and understanding of where COVID is within NHS Highland and what has caused the outbreaks. What we have done in terms of future control is that we've recruited on fixed term contracts further test and trace staff. We've also worked with Scottish Government and others and local authorities and the fire service to develop our testing processes so that testing across the whole of NHS Highland is certainly easier to access. And we've also put into practice the lessons that we've learned from previous outbreaks, so that our information systems and our control and the way that we manage is more efficient.
Thank you very much. And I think, again, perhaps for Tim Allison, can you provide an update of the rollout of the vaccination programme in the Highland area and tell us if there have been any ongoing issues for you with the vaccination programme? Tim Allison.
Thank you, convener. Our progress has been good so far. NHS Highland operates a somewhat different process from most health boards in terms of immunisation, in that we rely more on general practice for immunisation than the centralised immunisation service. And what that means is that we're better able to serve the very wide geography across Highland and Argyll and Bute, and particularly in lower population density islands and more remote areas. Our priorities in terms of starting the vaccination have been in line with the Scottish Government and JCVI in terms of care home residents, care home staff, NHS and social care patient-facing staff, as well as over 80s. Because we have a GP-focused community vaccination service, sometimes it doesn't quite fit in with some of the systems. So most of the data are recorded on a centralised system nationally, but it's taking a bit of time for the GP data to get through that. So the latest figures that we estimate for vaccinations are around 18,000 across the whole of NHS Highland, which means that we reckon that we've reached about a third of the over 80s. In two out of our three localities, we vaccinated or offered vaccination to all care homes, residents and staff. We're well through the patient-facing staff. Some GPs have pretty well completed their vaccination of over 80s. With some GPs, they're still getting the vaccine, but we anticipate that we will have vaccinated all the initial cohort by the end, by the first week in February. So the progress has been variable, I think, across the area, but overall, I believe we're making good progress.
Thanks. And a brief supplementary from Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Just on the vaccine, are you able, please, to give us any sort of sense of percentages in terms of residents in care homes, and also give us reassurance that GP practices in rural parts of the NHS Highland region will get the vaccine on time? So there have been some reports of delays getting it out to very rural areas.
Tim Allison.
Thank you. In terms of percentages, for our three localities, all the care homes in Argyll and Bute have been vaccinated. All our care homes in our north and west locality have been vaccinated, and we are working to vaccinate all the care homes in our south and mid locality by the end of this week. We have three care homes at the moment where there are outbreaks of COVID. So while we have been able to do some vaccination within there, we can't comprehensively vaccinate the care homes because it's not advisable or feasible in the middle of outbreaks. But we will complete that vaccination as soon as we can. So I can't give a precise percentage, but two out of three is 100%, and the other it should be 100% of what is feasible by the end of the week. In terms of getting vaccine out to rural areas, there have been some delays. That's correct in terms of getting the vaccine out. We're using a mixed model of the two vaccines in primary care in order to make sure that we maximise the speed and efficiency of vaccination. So we're using both the Pfizer vaccine and the AstraZeneca vaccine in general practice. The Pfizer vaccine as members will be aware, harder to transport. It's not impossible to get to remote areas, but it is more of a challenge. The AstraZeneca vaccine in most cases is delivered by a company which transports pharmaceuticals and does that generally for pretty well all pharmaceuticals regularly to practices. And there have been delays of a couple of days for some practices in those cases, but we're working with practices to try and minimise any difficulties caused by that. And we still anticipate, as I said earlier, getting the comprehensive first phase completed by the 5th or 6th of February.
Thanks. And Pam Dudek.
Thank you. A couple of things I just want to add to that. Last week we asked for some flexibility in terms of how we would deal with our islands in very remote and rural areas, and asked if we could take a bundle approach, and that was so that we could be more efficient and effective in the delivery of this vaccination programme, as well as ensuring that smaller communities were protected. And because obviously islands, etc., in terms of evacuation of patients, and that is very, very tricky. So we have had confirmation that flexibilities will be there to support us. We just need to set out for each scenario what it is that we will be doing, so that there is national sight of that. I think the second thing I want to make you aware of in mobilising this vaccination programme is that we have worked very closely over the last week to 10 days with the Highland Council and with Argyll and Bute councils to understand how they can support us in the delivery of this. And both councils have been excellent in responding to that in terms of supplying us with people to coordinate where we might deliver the vaccines, offer of domestic staff to do the cleaning and stewardship, working also with communities to support that effort and getting people for their vaccinations. So that gives us a really robust backdrop to what we need our clinicians to do versus what other agencies can do to support us to be successful in this delivery. And I think that's really significant and really good partnership working. And we're also looking at joint comms so that we're messaging very clearly in the same way. So I think that that's been a very positive relationship and something that that makes us very confident in what we're doing. And in terms of this wave one, in the numbers that we have to vaccinate and where we expect to be by the 6th of February at the moment, we feel fairly confident in our delivery of that. We have modelling done locally. We know what our numbers are. When you break that up across general practice, it's a much more manageable figure.
Thanks very much. And I have a brief supplementary from Sandra White.
The opening question from the convener was about ongoing challenges. And in the reply, you mentioned Home Farm and Sky HC1, the private provider, which was bought over by the Scottish Government for just £900,000. Now, I'm looking at the brokerage, which was also, you know, asked at that particular time by the convener. Will this have ongoing challenges and a knock-on effect to brokerage and costs for yourselves, for the health board?
Question about the financial implications of Home Farm.
Yes.
David Garden.
Thank you, convener. Yes, the cost of us running Home Farm is a fair bit more expensive than it would be to purchase the activity from the independent sector, but £1.3 million per annum more for us to run it, and that's primarily around higher wages and on costs such as pension costs, etc. In the current year, government have provided additional funding up to the 31st of March to help us get over that hump in terms of the additional costs, and it will form part of our planning and discussions going into next year.
Thank you.
One of the wider questions that is bound to arise in Highland as elsewhere is the indirect impact of lockdown and the focus on COVID. Can I ask Boyd Robertson in the first instance, what indirect health impacts are you most concerned about, and what action is being taken to mitigate against such harms? Boyd Robertson.
Thank you, convener. One of the impacts, obviously, is on our staff and on the resilient staff in the most of circumstances. And we've put in place a number of initiatives to cater for that. We have national initiatives as well in terms of well-being, but we have our own local initiatives as well. And we have a newsletter that goes out every week to all members of staff offering advice of varying types to them. We also have an employee assistance programme which is open 24/7 to all employees, and I'll bring Pam in to elaborate on these items. We also have community resilience facilities, and again, as Pam mentioned, we have very good cooperation and collaboration with councils in running these community centres. Communities themselves from very active community response to COVID, which has helped. I ask Pam to come in and say a little bit more on that.
Thank you very much. Pam Dudek.
Thank you. So I'll start off with the staff impacts just to finish that up. So as Boyd has said, we have a number of formal ways in which we can offer support to staff, and we have Wellbeing Wednesday where lots of tips and advice go out to staff. But I guess some of the simpler things and the daily things that make a difference from the feedback I've had is about being recognised, it's about being thanked, about being supported. We're straight into the culture here, and simple things like coffee, tea and break areas as being significant. So we have absolutely emphasised with leads in our system to ensure that these things are happening and in place, and that we are acknowledging the work that's being done. So that's in the staffing context. The other indirect health impacts that I think are really of greatest concern, I suppose, to everybody from the conversations I've had, are the impact on people's mental health, the isolation, drug and alcohol use. And of course, some communities are seeing the really severe end of that, and how that impacts families with loss of life through drug overdose or suicide, and just general anxiety, stress and distress. And so we are very much looking at how we work with our partners and with communities to support initiatives that can help address that. I now meet on a regular basis with the Chief Commander of the Police, the Fire and Rescue Scottish Ambulance, and the Highland Council Chief Exec. And I'm looking to have something similar with Argyll and Bute. And that's about us taking a collective effort with communities, with local elected members, to see how we can progress around that. We actually do have a bit of an initiative going on, particularly around the Caithness area, and we will look to how that methodology works and see if we can take that across other areas in a more concerted effort and reshape how we respond to these kinds of issues, which are not always required to be medicalised. Sometimes it's very much about a social response. So we're trying to work with people to get that right response.
Thank you very much. I'll now move to the questions of wider financial sustainability and call on David Stewart.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Professor Robertson, and all our witnesses from NHS Highland. Members will know that NHS Highland is my home board, and I want to thank them for the regular contact information sharing that they have carried out during the COVID crisis. My first question is, will the board achieve financial balance in 2021-22? Bearing in mind what the Auditor General said in this context, and I quote, "I consider these forecasts to be unrealistic, given NHS Highland's poor performance in identifying and achieving savings in recent years."
Boyd Robertson.
I think that comment was made in the context of the 18-19 report, auditor's report, and we achieved in 1920 £28 million savings target, in fact exceeded it, and had reduced brokerage from the government because of that quite remarkable performance, which outstripped that of any other board in the country. So we are on track, and we were well on track to achieve the financial turnaround that we need in order to be de-escalated from level four, is one of my aspirations in this role. I'm going to ask David Garden to elaborate on what I'm saying here, but the current year, we were on track again to deliver the savings program, the savings target that we had, which again was around 24 million. And of course, COVID intervened, and there are all sorts of cost consequentials arising from COVID. But I'll get David to come in now.
David Barton.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Stewart's absolutely correct that the comment made by the Auditor General at the time was around lack of confidence in our delivery to reach financial balance in 21-22. But the context of that was against our 2018-19 annual accounts. I think members will be aware that we had a government-led support team with the help of PwC, brought in shortly around the time that the Auditor General made those comments, and the changes that have been put in place in NHS Highland have been transformational. They really have. The systems we have in place in terms of allowing ourselves to identify cost savings and cost improvements across the whole system are transparent, they're robust, they're tested, and as Boyd mentioned, that we delivered last year 2019-20 around £28.4 million of savings, and a significant proportion of those savings, almost 70%, were recurrent in nature, and that's been quite unusual in the NHS in recent years, where mostly boards make non-recurrent savings, and that just accumulates the underlying deficit going forward. We were making really, really good progress coming into this financial year. In February last year, we were on course to develop plans for this year, but of course, the inevitable happened around COVID. We'd stand down much of our cost improvement programme for the early part of spring and summer. We've picked it back up again. We're on target to deliver around £20 million savings in the current year in spite of COVID. We continue to apply those robust systems in place. The question around whether we'll deliver 21-22 financial break-even is a very good one, and one that I can't answer right now, because until we unravel the impact of COVID and what services are going to look like next year, I really can't say right now whether we are still on target or not to deliver that aspiration.
David Stewart.
Thank you, Commissioner. Could I ask perhaps the question in a slightly different way? What level of financial support, otherwise called brokerage, will be required from the Scottish Government on a recurring and non-recurring basis? And I suppose, just to summarise my question, I mean, is the board sustainable without brokerage from the Scottish Government?
David Garden.
Thank you, Kinnear. So in the current year, Mr Stewart, we're expecting £8.8 million of financial brokerage. That was part of the plan that we had at this time last year, and we hope to deliver that, subject to COVID funding that we're expecting to be announced in the next few weeks. In terms of recurrent brokerage, we're not expecting nor planning for such a thing. It doesn't really exist. And brokerage is a temporary arrangement to allow us to deliver targets while we transform and reduce our cost base. So we're expecting £8.8 million in the current year. Next year, we were hoping to require zero. I expect that we will require some now. The level of that, I'm not able to ascertain at this point in time, but we still feel that we are in a position to deliver a sustainable financial balance over time. It's just COVID may have delayed or stretched that timescale slightly.
David Stewart.
Thank you for that answer, Mr. Gard. My final question, I suppose, is a fundamental one, particularly in my mind, actually, of the board, which I've got some experience of. A recurring theme over the years has been chronic overspending in three areas. One, locum medical staffing, secondly, drugs, and thirdly, social care. And if I can give you one example from the first in local medical staffing, I found an article from the Sunday Times in November 2018, which alleged that consultants on a locum basis were being paid £400,000 a year. Now, I appreciate all of you are new and weren't in your substantial posts in 2018, but this is, you know, you don't need to be an accountant to work out if you're paying £400,000 for locum staff, you're going to have real problems with your budget. Is it fair to summarise these three recurring themes? If you can sort these out, is that the road to financial sustainability?
David Garden.
It's certainly part of it. We put a lot of work into reducing our locum use. Unfortunately, we've been slightly knocked offside on that one around some changes at a UK level to pension taxation, which meant that quite a number of consultants have reduced their time, and we've had to backfill that with additional locums. Certainly even last in locature than we were the previous year, so we're certainly making inroads into that, and there's a work stream within our cost improvement programme led by our medical directors looking at reducing locum expenditure in particular, and looking at sustainable recruitment, which is the key obviously to all of those issues. In terms of drugs, we aren't seeing such a problem in drugs in the current year. The main problems in drugs are around short supply, which is primarily around COVID and primary care prescribing. Simple drugs such as sertraline, which is a very common antidepressant drug, the price has rocketed due to short supply. But in terms of acute drugs, we're not seeing huge pressures in there. Again, we have a work stream led by our director of pharmacy and medical director looking again at that area such as drugs. In terms of adult social care, you're absolutely right. That is our third area. Pam mentioned earlier that we are working very closely with the Highland Council. We've convened a joint programme management board of the council to look at how we might transform social care services and deliver most improvements in those areas. So yes, I think Mr. Stewart, you've hit the nail on the head with the three areas that we have significant problems in, but we are taking action in each of those areas to bring the cost down over time.
Pam Dudek.
Thank you. So I think in a kind of linear way that though that's right, that those are the three areas that we need to tackle. But of course, the real leadership challenge for us is what does a modern health and social care system look like, and what is the shape of the workforce that needs to support that. So whilst we will address the immediate situation as it stands, underpinning that has to be the change that needs to happen. And integration across our health and social care system and communities is a huge part of that in terms of how we address social care. And we will be looking, as Dave says, to really step up our transformation plan around that in collaboration with Highland Council to address the deficit, but understand the quality, the size and the shape of the services that we need, and optimising that integrated resource in terms of doing the right things to get good outcomes for our population. I think within our medical staffing, there too, there are lots of changes happening for several years now in terms of the blend of staff and understanding when you absolutely need a doctor and when we have other disciplines who can be trained to a level where they can contribute to the outcomes that we're trying to deliver. So I think you can't lose sight of that need for a wider change and to be looking to the future and not just keep reinventing what we've done before where it's possible to do so.
Thank you very much. I now call Emma Harper.
Good morning, convener. Good morning, everybody. And good morning to our panel. I'm interested to know a wee bit about COVID-19 funding. I know that on the 29th of September, the Cabinet Secretary announced 1.1 billion in additional funding for NHS boards and health and social care partnerships to meet the COVID-19 related costs. So I'm interested to know how much additional funding NHS Highland received to meet the COVID-19 costs. And has this covered the additional costs resulting from the pandemic?
David Gordon.
Thank you. So to date, in terms of additional funding that NHS Highland has received, we've actually received £47.4 million of funding already in the current year. And that's under a range of different headings, specifically for adult social care funding, urgent care, for one or two other areas of funding. We've submitted on Friday an update on our estimate of COVID expenditure for the current year, and we're expecting that to increase by another £20 million in total by the end of the year, giving a total cost of £67 million. Now, that includes the social care elements within both the Highland Partnership and their Galmbute IGB, as well as the health service costs directly. But those are what we're planning for in terms of funding from government.
Emma Harper.
Okay, thank you. And I note that some savings have also been made because of the pandemic, and notably to do with reduced spending on drugs and reduced spending on surgical instruments and associated supplies, and travel and subsistence. And I'm interested in the continued anticipated savings, especially the travel and subsistence, as NHS Highland have a programme that supports that for obvious reasons because of islands and rurality. NHS Dumfries and Galloway don't have that, and I'm keen to hear about whether the travel and subsistence and other savings, are you anticipating that you will have continued reduced spending in those areas?
Pam Dudek.
Thank you. Well, I would absolutely hope that that would be the case. And that's really, again, looking to the future and our climate duty concerns as even a starter for 10. So, you know, the COVID has transformed the way we've worked. I mean, the virtual meeting is very common now, and the way that we do our work. So it's a huge opportunity to get people off the roads and still have the connections and be able to do our work as best we can. And we are also using, you know, Near Me to a greater extent. And again, that's part of a bigger change programme of clinicians getting used to working in that way and the public getting used to receiving their care in that way when it's appropriate to do so. So I would absolutely hope that we would continue to see in our transformation. And a blend between in our business. And that brings an efficiency. As I say, it means that we're contributing to our climate duty and generally making it easier for our workforce and hopefully the public to access services and maximise the time and resource that we've got.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Are you monitoring the mileage reduction because of like Teams meetings? Is that something that you're able to look at mileage savings and then correlate that with CO2 emissions or any carbon reduction? Is that something that you've started tracking?
I don't have the specifics on that, but it's a good question and it's absolutely something that we should be trying to do. I don't know if Dave Garden can answer anything around the tracking of that at the moment, but we can certainly come back to you on that and also take it away if we haven't done that to think about how we might.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I'll go back to Emma Harper and then we'll take Dave Garden after that. Emma Harper.
Yeah, I mean, and I'm interested in that kind of information because we've got, you know, a rural country where the attend anywhere, near me, Zoom meetings, team meetings are really reducing the amount of time that people are spending on the roads. But that's something that you don't have to give me an answer to right now, but I'm just interested in whether we will monitor it or how we're looking at that in the future. I can continue with my additional questions, Convener, if that's...
Yes, please. That,
yeah, okay. And okay, so some further funding on GP practices. Are you able to tell us how much additional extra funding was given to GP practices and for what services is that for? Was it for digital interventions or other opening, additional opening hours type of service?
David Garden.
Are you referring to COVID funding, Ms. Harper?
Yes, additional COVID funding to be provided for GPs in NHS Highlands. So are you able to outline a bit more detail about what the services were delivered from that funding?
I personally don't have actually details at hand. I can certainly find that and get that to you once this meeting is over. But certainly there has been funding to practices to support opening of public holidays and to support the extension of urgent care and out of hours care. I don't have that detail right now to hand, I'm afraid.
That would certainly be helpful to have after the meeting. Emma Harper.
Okay, thanks, Convener. I would be interested to look at or hear about the additional funding just to see how we're spending all of that. The final question, Convener, is NHS Highland able to provide information on how much has been spent on social prescribing during the past year? Our committee are very interested in social prescribing and how that funds people to help keep them out of hospital and whether NHS Highland has a commitment to support social prescribing.
Thank you very much. Pam Dudek.
I'll ask Dave if he has any figures handy. Again, it might be one that we have to come back to you on, but I'm in terms of through the COVID period, I don't have an exact figure to mind to give you. But as I said before, it's definitely an ambition that we, around prevention, that we really look more focused at what can be done and what our contribution is as a health board to that. I know that when I've been involved in this in other boards, we were asked to consider what our baseline was, and that sat around a percentage of about 4% on prevention, which could be obviously a number of interventions. But social prescribing is a very strong place in a prevention strategy. And I would need to go back and see what work NHS Highland has done previously on this, unless Dave has anything at hand. But it's certainly another area that, as we get back into the sort of business as usual, that we definitely should be considering further. Not to say David it doesn't Garden. Have a place in COVID, but yeah.
David Garden.
I'm sorry, I don't have any actual numbers available either. But as Pam said, we do engage. We have an active referral scheme, for example, but we can actually go back and give information after this meeting, that's okay.
Okay, that's fine. Emma Harper.
Final question of one example would be that pulmonary rehabilitation helps keep people out of hospital from exacerbations of chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. And there's a respiratory care action plan is being developed right now. And I know because of the rurality of the Highlands, just like in my patch in the south of Scotland, remote pulmonary rehab is something that is being developed. So third sector would help deliver that. So would that be something that NHS Highland would be interested in looking at as part of the social prescribing development to support keeping folk out of hospital for lung ill health, for instance?
Pam Dudek.
Yes, thank you. So pulmonary rehab and respiratory care is one of our biggest reasons for admission, and one of the biggest areas of disease that most health boards have a focus on. And I used to be the long-term conditions programme manager in Grampian many years ago, so it's an area I'm very familiar with. And as you say, the evidence base for that delivery model is really robust and absolutely involves much wider sectors than the public sector. So I'm familiar with remote pulmonary rehab as well, being delivered very successfully. So very keen that we work on that basis first. So we'll look into that further locally as to where we're at with that. So thank you.
Tim Allison.
Thank you. I just want to add a couple of brief things around the area of social prescribing. I think what's particularly important is to link it with other areas. So we've been doing work on active travel, which links up with the reduction in car travel and also home working. But we can link social prescribing and engagement with other organisations to a wide variety of work of the health board. And so, for example, there's been excellent work in the planning for the new hospital in Aviemore, linking up with National Park and with local voluntary sector organisations, and linking up with in terms of travel and community links. So it crosses the whole work of the board, and it can be seen as separate social prescribing, but also needs to be inherent in a lot of the other work that we do.
Thank you very much. I now call on Brian Whittle.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. I wanted to ask around questions around the workforce challenges at NHS Highland, I think, which have been raised on several occasions, specifically around the continued issue around high levels of vacancies requiring a higher use of locums. I think in October 2020, the turnover rate was sitting at 7.7% and the vacancy rate at 7.9%. Now, I do know that you have been working on a strategy to support the attraction, recruitment, retention of staff and build that resilient workforce. So can I start by asking for an update on what progress has been made to reduce staff turnover and vacancies in relation to the board's 2021 targets?
Pam Dudek.
Yeah, so I mean, I guess the overarching strategy is to make NHS Highland an attractive place to work and a good experience for people. What I can tell you is that we have obviously taken, as many boards have, a range of ways of trying to engage people in terms of whether they want to work within the kind of more urban areas of Inverness, or particularly focused around our remote and rural recruitment. And we have been successful on the island of Rathay with the nursing team that we worked with the community to establish that. I think you heard about that the last time NHS Highland presented, and in Argyll and Bute and some of the islands with our GP recruitment. And so I suppose it's about how you package things for people, and we've certainly been looking to how we do that and attract people in that way. I'm pleased to let you know that we have seen a significant shift in interest in posts in NHS Highland. And I think when I was at the PAPLS committee, I alluded to this, and definitely we are trying to understand what the motivation is there. And I'm hoping it's because we're an attractive place to come and live and work. But it could also be people are making different life choices in the wake of the pandemic. But we have had some very successful recruitment around our consultants too, in physicians in Caithness, orthodontists, radiologists recently, two more that add to the two that we had in the last quarter of last year. One of those being for Lorna Niles and one for Rig Moore. We've seen the recruitment of more anaesthetists at Caithness and Belford. And in Belford, the anaesthetist is also a pain specialist, so that helps us with our wider strategy around pain management. There are still some areas like urology where we have a 50% vacancy of the six consultants we should have, but we have some regional discussions going on around that. ENT surgeon, four physicians, one in Lorna Niles and three in Rake Moore, two paediatricians, haematologists. So we've been pretty successful of late, in say the last 6 months, and fill in some of these traditionally hard to recruit to posts. So we're hoping that if we keep spreading the word, quite often the word from peers is as effective as anything that we can do. The narrative about the organisation, the opportunity within the organisation, and then the life work balances seem to be important to people, as you would imagine. So I feel that we are seeing something much more positive, and we'll monitor that vacancy rate that you've stated to see if we see the ultimate impact of that and our locum spend, because clearly this should have a further impact. The more permanent staff we have, the less agency and locum spend that we have. Our leadership posts as well, we've seen enormous numbers applying for our leadership posts, double figures. And a couple of those senior posts towards the end of the year, we had up to 38 for one post and 50 for another at director level. So we're seeing people from across the world and across the UK interested in coming to work for us.
Very much. Brian Whittle.
Thank you. My next quick question was going to be around the impact of COVID-19 on the existing workforce pressures. I wanted to ask around about absenteeism through the COVID-19 pandemic, but also really interested in your thoughts there around the potential for sort of lifestyle changes and how that might positively impact rural areas like the Highlands, and wondered whether or not you would consider doing a little bit of a study or keep monitoring that to see, one, is that actually happening, and two, where people are moving from to join the workforce. So two sides to that question, if I may.
Pam Dudek.
Okay, thank you. I think in terms of the lifestyle changes and understanding and looking at the information we have to understand the kind of patterns there, I think that's something that we would do anyway, because we need to understand what works and how we can build on that. I think, again, sort of alluding back to the flexible working that we can now do, does afford us a whole host of opportunities as well. So, you know, coming in and living up here rurally and taking up posts does allow you to work in a more flexible way now that we have teams up and running and near me working well. So that there are ways that we can be creative with some of the job plans to ensure that we can give people the best opportunity to do their job well, and also make that fit with a remote and rural setting. And also looking at, you know, working with our communities is an important aspect, because where communities are thriving, where we can disperse our workforce, we then contribute to the economy. And so there's a whole host of ways in which we as the board can make a difference. And we're also looking with partners at how we could really strengthen the potential of apprenticeships and, you know, really giving hope to some of our young people. Our absence rate has really, in the last wave, didn't go to the level that we expected it to, and it sits on average around 5%, which is slightly higher than we'd want it to be. We've obviously, you know, had the challenges of people shielding, of staff isolating, and that will continue with testing, etc. But so far, we have been managing really well. We've got a very resilient and committed staff. We just need to make sure that we keep them there and support them in that way. But the motivation and the passion that I've come across from people has been really impressive, even when people are not always 100% happy. You know, even when morale's low, you can't cut through the passion for being at work and Ryan the job Hurtle. They do.
Ryan Hurtle.
Thank you. And if I finally, convener, I could just ask, related to obviously the pressures in the workforce of COVID-19, can I ask how many and what proportion of NHS Highland staff have been vaccinated against COVID-19 to date?
Tim Allison or Pam did it?
We, as of last night, and Tim will be correcting me, it was about just under 7,000. And we're opening up from today the health, the Life Science Centre to do large scale vaccination of our health and care staff. And we have the capacity there, as long as we have the vaccine, to do 1,000 a day. And our kind of target number for staff is something in the region of 13,500. So we're on track with that and now doing quite well. We had obviously quite a significant change in the approach that came through on Hogmanay, and we worked over that weekend with our planning team to try and get some numbers and modelling so that we could hit the ground well on the 4th to try and readjust our plan. So I think we've made reasonable progress there.
Thank you very much, Tim Allison. Is there anything else to say on that one?
There's not a lot to say. I think we're making good progress. Of course, as well as looking to immunise our own staff, both health and social care, there are other community health staff, GPs, dentists, that we're also inviting to immunise. So, there are challenges, but I think we're making good progress.
Thank you very much. And now call on David Torrance.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. My questions are around Raigmore Hospital. The external audit report commented that NHS Highland continues to experience pressures in relation to Raigmore Hospital. In 2019-20, was a 2.4 million overspend. Will NHS Highland overspend in relation to Raigmore Hospital? And if so, how has this been addressed?
David Gordon.
Thank you, convener. Yes, the £2.4 million was the overspend for Raigmore in 2019-20, and that was primarily driven by unexpected locum costs and some higher than expected drug costs. But what we did do going into 2021 was to do a review on historic budgets that we set. There were some areas of Rigmore Hospital which have been overspending for a number of years that we recognised that perhaps we needed to review the budgets and in recognition of the current activity levels and the kind of work they're doing. So we did a what we called a budget rebasing exercise for Rigmore for all of our services, actually coming into this year, so that we started this year on a, if you like, a clean slate. Now, Rigmore in the current year are forecasting a break-even position. It's difficult to understand exactly what's driving that because of COVID, of course, because we've got less elective activity, but we've got more costs around COVID than we would normally have. But we're monitoring it very, very carefully and very closely. And Rigmore are very much part of our recovery programme and our cost improvement scheme, and they have contributed very significantly to the work that we've done in the last almost 2 years to return to balance. So we've done a lot of work. There's been a lot of improvements. This year's break even, but not entirely sure. We can see that's all down to improved financial management or COVID, and we'll have some part to play in it, I'm sure.
Pam Dudek.
Thank you. I probably can't emphasise enough the surveillance over the cost improvement plan of all sectors, including Rigmore, and as Dave has said, the engagement of our teams in that. So, you know, this is led from the departments in terms of what can be achieved and what's realistic in terms of change or efficiency. And their engagement in that has been really, really strong. And that's both clinical and managerial. And the Financial Recovery Board meets every week. And even in COVID, we have been meeting every week since May. And whilst we've put it on a simmer, is what I am describing it, so that we are optimising the focus of that, the agenda, and who's around the table, so that we're not pulling clinicians away from clinical work in COVID, we are not taking our foot off the pedal. So I don't think I've experienced surveillance and engagement in a cost improvement plan or on the bottom line before, and I've been in the health service since 1982.
Thank you very much. David Torrance.
And my final question, convener, how will NHS Highland make shift from acute services to increased community care as recommended in the recent audit report?
Pam Dudek.
Thank you. So this is, as it is with every area, every health and social care partnership is a reshaping agenda. I think in terms of the kind of models of care and the shift and change that we can achieve, that really has to happen through the integration agenda and looking at how our integrated teams with third sector and with communities can make a difference in how much we can do on a home first basis. So how much care, what's the ceiling of care that we can support to the right quality level at home for people across the Highlands and North Island Butte. And then when that's not possible, what is the requirement of a hospital admission? And you'll, I'm sure, be aware that our delayed discharges is not in a good place. They're absolutely not where we would want to be on the league table. And therefore, there is a need for a concerted piece of work in North Highland, which is underway. And there's quite a strong programme approach to that in terms of trying to recover that position. In Argyll and Butte, that's slightly different. That generally, Argyll and Butte are in a very good position in their delayed discharges, and their way of working seems to be delivering those outcomes. And again, we look at what we can learn. We're looking at what we can learn from that. So we've currently in Inverness got a project which is we're referring to as an enhanced community programme, which has had some additional funding, seed funding, to try and establish that change and shift that needs to happen, that one, prevents admission, and two, expedites discharge. And there are some changes happening in the next couple of weeks that, as part of that project, that will hopefully make a difference in our, and we expect to make a difference in our delayed discharge performance in North Highland. So we'll need to keep close surveillance of that. And so this is all about redesign, it is all about shift. And my experience being a chief officer of an IGB before is that the shift is something you can achieve. The money is a different thing. So how we move from how bond budgets have been historically to what they may need to be to support that level of shift is still a challenge for most people. But we do note that at the moment, you know, we have around 100 delayed discharges, 60 standard, and a number of those in Raig Mohr, that if we can remove those delays, we potentially have got something to work with. So it's on that basis that we're trying to make the shift and change.
Thank you very much. And can I call Boyd Robert?
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to make a point that we have made strategic decisions as well around community and acute, in that we had one Chief Operating Officer post in the recent past, and we have now created two posts, one dedicated to community and one dedicated to acute services. And also, we want to make the point that the Chief Operating Officer for Acute Services looks after not just Raig Mohr Hospital, but the three district general hospitals in Caithness, in Belford, Fort William, and in Lorne and the Isles in Oban. And it's a one hospital, four sites approach.
Thank you very much. And I move on to the questions raised by the Sturrock report, and I call on Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Convener. Can I firstly ask what improvements have been made since the publication of the Sturrock report in relation to bullying?
Pam Dudek.
Thank you. I'm pretty sure the chair will want to comment on this as well. There's been quite a significant framework being put in place to address the recommendations of the Sturrock report. And we have what we call a culture oversight group that is inclusive of people who were part of bringing the issues to our attention, and who are experts in the field of organisational development and how we take this forward. That programme has got a number of work streams that are ongoing. I think the journey so far has a big, influence on what happened to those people who were harmed, and on understanding the size of the issue, both not just in North Highland, but in Argyll and Bute. So we've had, for those people who were harmed, the healing process, and we have got 200 registrants for that as it stands at the moment. And we are working through the cohorts of people who have had their recommendations made to us from the independent panel as we speak. We expect that to continue well into the rest of this year, and that programme in itself affords people the opportunity to get support and counselling, allows them to discuss their experience and express that to an independent panel, and indeed they can have an apology, there's organisational learning, or indeed a financial component. So in terms of trying to help people to move on or accept or cope with what they've experienced, and some of those people still work for us, that healing process has been significant. I think the other improvements have been around how people can speak up confidentially and advise us on what the issues are that are coming to that they're experiencing, and a mechanism then to respond promptly to that, or indeed in many cases for that to be closed down concluded just by that independent, private, confidential conversation. We have employee assistance, which is there to support people psychologically, and we have, on a day-to-day basis, been trying to set the tone, certainly encourage an ethos of respect and support for people across the organisation. We have also had some training around courageous conversations, etc. I could probably go on, but I think Boyd would probably want to say a bit more about the culture piece.
Certainly. Boyd Robertson. Yep. Boyd Robertson.
Yes, indeed. Culture change is a long-term programme of work. It's not a short-term initiative. And to really bring about change in culture, you have to understand the difficulties that arose and what lay behind them. And to that end, I have engaged with a whistleblowers group on a regular basis. I've also engaged with people who have been harmed and heard their stories at first hand. And then we had a two-day workshop in Inverness with board members present, and the board members heard examples of the harm that had been wrought on certain individuals, both firsthand and through written submissions. But we also went out to our staff more widely in a series of engagement sessions. We had 23 such sessions in 11 locations across our very extensive patch. I need hardly remind you that Highland covers 41% of the landmass of Scotland, and it's not easy to reach out to all areas, but we did make a concerted effort to do that. We also instituted, as Stellick had recommended, a review of culture in Argyll and Bute, which was done by Progressive Partnership, an independent organisation, and the results of that were broadly in line with those identified by Stellick. We have recently had further close working with the whistleblowers group, who also co-produced the healing process. But in this latest activity, we have had our external culture advisor, who's the chair of the culture oversight group that Pam referred to. We have had her leading on this piece of work with the whistleblowers, looking at the root causes of the issues that arose in 2018, or that were manifested at least in 2018. And that piece of work will inform future development of our action plan. And also, as Pam referred to the healing process, the panel engaged in the healing process activities, they are producing reports for us on a quarterly basis, and indicating what learning, organisational learning, needs to be had from the hearings that they have had with individual who have suffered bullying and inappropriate behaviour. So we're building up a reservoir of information about the things that went wrong in the organisation, and we have, in the steps that Pam has outlined and in other elements like training, for instance, courageous conversation training, which has extended already to about 500 of our staff, and Civility Saves Lives, another initiative, we are addressing these issues. And May 2021, this year, we'll see the anniversary of the publication of the Stellick report. And by that time, we hope to have engaged in a further engagement exercise with staff to gauge their response to the initiatives that we've undertaken.
Thank you very much. Donald Cameron.
Thank you very much for those answers. Can I ask about current levels of bullying within NHS Highland? What are those, and have they increased as a result of extra pressures caused by the pandemic?
Pam Dudek.
Thank you. In terms of, the balance here is between official figures, so, you know, those who have gone, come forward and raised a grievance, versus, you know, what is the tone and culture across the organisation. So if I start off with the formal figures first, we've got 23 open cases under the bullying and harassment policy as it stands at the moment. And 9 have been open for a significant period of time, more than 9 months. Now, those tend to be fairly complex and may be multifactorial, and certainly the push from myself and others is to conclude those as quickly as possible, because that in itself is not a good process for people. So of the 23 currently open, we've got 1 that's at early resolution, 9 are at the investigation stage, 3 are currently at hearing stage, and 10 are at appeal and review stage. The previous 12 months, there were 32 cases raised and 17 had been resolved, 5 of which recommended no action, 2 had been unable to proceed due to people leaving the organisation, 5 resolved through early intervention and resolution, which is obviously where we would really like to be, 3 have recommended support, improvement and facilitation, and 2 have recommended disciplinary action. So that hopefully gives you a little bit of the flavour of the kind of mix of what that looks like. I think the kind of striking thing when you're in a crisis or when you're dealing with a common issue is that it does tend to bring people together, and that what we've seen is some really impressive collaborative working and teams working together and really trying to support each other. Not to be too rosy about it though, I'm also aware that when people are under pressure, and we are, you know, a very pressured system, that sometimes you can get the worst of people. I think we're all human beings, it's a human system run by humans, that's relationship based, so there are going to be times when things get fraught and perhaps people don't behave in the right way. And what we need to get a better handle on is just how well we deal with that, how well our middle management in particular are equipped. And I say I'm going to emphasise that I'm not blaming middle management. Middle management is a very tricky job, a very challenging job. I've done it myself, and you have a lot of things to balance. We have a responsibility to ensure that everybody has the confidence to deal with those situations and try and keep a calm and positive and supportive environment. And if not, know who they can turn to for support. So I think it would be difficult for me to say that we are all rosy and everything's great, because I don't think any organisation could actually say that. However, we are absolutely trying to get out those key messages and trying to support the system, to support the people who work for us in the best way possible, as well as to be able to have the right conversations when something's not quite right and not let it fester or get worse.
Donald Cameron.
Thank you. I've got two more questions, one technical and one about evaluation. If I can ask the technical one first. I gather that there was an issue with whether tax was payable on compensation payment, and that you wrote to HMRC about this. Have you heard back from HMRC about that issue?
David Gordon.
No, thanks, Convener. We haven't had a response as yet. No.
Thank you. Donald Cameron.
Thank you. My final question is about evaluation. What system have you got in place to evaluate progress being made along the general lines of bullying, etc., in terms of scrutiny?
Lloyd Robertson.
We have various metrics that we are putting in place. We have the Argyle and Butte survey that was done. I mentioned that we are intending to conduct another survey more widely of staff throughout the Highland area, both Argyle and Butte and North Highland. We have the data that comes through the systems the various reporting systems that we have and the ones that Pam has already outlined in terms of the uptake of the Speak Up service, the Guardian Speak Up service, which is the only one in existence in Scotland, incidentally. So these are some of them. But we also have a whistleblowing champion in place for around a year now, and he actually has not had much brought to his attention. Direct contact with him has been very, very limited. Obviously, he hasn't been able to get out and about as much because of COVID, but he will be engaging very soon in Argyll and Bute with staff there in a virtual manner rather than the preferable way of going face to face with people in communities. But these are just some of the ways in which we are measuring the progress.
Thank you very much. And a brief supplementary from David Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Just for the record, Convener, just want to make it clear to the panel that I've evolved with the bullying issue for the last couple of years. But the key point I think to make is if we can change the culture of the organisation and get bullying out of the system, make that a concept of the past, that of course will help our recruitment and our retention of staff, which was something that was referred to earlier by other members of the committee.
Pam Dudek.
Yeah, just to add that one of our work streams in the Culture Programme Board is to get a set of measures that we can look at on an annual basis or on a regular basis, over and above the normal things we do, to be able to have surveillance of that. We've also just listening to the Guardians, you know, seeing the Guardian service reports and getting the feedback on themes from them gives us a bit of a flavour of what might have been somebody raising an issue that might have been that they were actually, you know, to some extent being managed and being asked to do aspects of their job as opposed to somebody being bullied. We've also created a listening email. Well, that probably sounds a bit contrary, but we have a central email, which is another mechanism by which people can raise issues. So all of these things together with the diagnostics, there's a whole host of things we've done, are kind of giving us the key themes, which again gives us a confidence about the interventions that we need to make. And certainly as an exec team, we're trying to address our visibility by a number of different comms and doing videos and, you know, encouraging people to speak up and to be there, you know, to look after each other.
Thank you very much. And Boyd Robertson on that area.
I just wanted to agree completely with David Stewart's analysis that what we do on the culture front will be key to the future of the organisation. Changing our culture, transforming our culture is absolutely central. And Pam and I are trying to set a new tone in the organisation. I think we have been successful in that, and we want to see that continue. And we want to do that in partnership with those who were affected and who are represented in the whistleblowers group.
Thank you very much. Now, Colin George Adam.
Good morning, Convener, and good morning to everyone. I'd like to ask a question with regards to risk management. Now, I'm aware that NHS Highland are aware that there's key areas that they've got high risk in, but in a letter to our committee received from the Public Audit and Post Legislative Committee, we actually heard that there was a number of very high risk areas. And one in particular that's quite concerning, especially in the times that we're living in at the moment, was the high number of vacancies in trained mental health nursing, including CAMHS and the psychiatric medical posts, with an insufficient level of nurse graduates to meet demand. Now, can you tell me what is the current situation with that at the moment?
Pam Dudek.
Thank you. So I don't have the exact figures in front of me, but I will get them for you. In fact, I'm they might be in one of the papers I've got, but generally we do have a challenge around vacancies with mental health, just as you've described, as many boards do. So there's a national challenge around psychiatry and mental health nurses, and we are looking at what that means for us as a service. And that kind of relates to something that I talked about earlier. So generally in mental health, there are aspects that require those specialists, and there are aspects that require a broader response in primary care, out in the community, and our kind of social response. Thus why we're trying to look at how that pathway develops for people who have stress and distress through to people who have fairly severe and enduring mental health problems. So that strategic approach is underway under the leadership of our chief officers for the Health and Social Care Partnerships, with whom mental health services sit. And that strategy is being developed with people with lived experience and with will be with our communities. CAMHS is, again, an area, as you rightly point out, that has continued to be a significant challenge for us in terms of recruitment to the levels that we would need. And we have set up a specific focus and recovery board to address that. And again, there's quite a number of aspects that need to be considered in that. And I've come from a board where 4 years ago we had a real challenge with CAMHS, both in terms of the right level of funding being applied to it, and in terms of how it fitted with a slick programme of access that meant families and children got quick access and dealt with early as possible. And so I have obviously had that experience and have connections in that board, and have linked up our leads and our programme board with that learning journey, so that we can perhaps adopt some of those strategies and make a difference. I think the other aspect for CAMHS that's really important to us, and I've been speaking to Highland Council and the HSEP in Argyll and Bute, is that link up with early intervention. So I think in most CAMHS areas where you don't have a very well established early intervention through to, again, severe issues pathway, then people naturally find themselves on a waiting list for CAMHS when perhaps an early intervention could have prevented that. So we have the right discussions in place. We've got a programme board led by the right people in terms of the professionals, and we'll be working with those using our service to try and redefine that in a way that works for us in the Highlands. Again, noting a remote and rural nature, and then the ability to use remote means to have contact with individuals and their families. So we have quite a lot of work to do. We're absolutely not where we would want to be, but we do have a plan to try and take that forward and make significant improvements.
Georgia.
Convener, thank you. Pam, what are the actual timescales on these strategies that you have to sort this out? Do you have a plan to know where you're going to have made some movement forward? When?
So the way I try to approach these things is, and particularly when things aren't good, is, so what's the here and now response that we can put in place to try and stabilise things, to allow us to do a good bit of strategic planning and move the service forward for the future? So we've taken some here and now decisions, I suppose, around recruitment, allowing permanent recruitment to posts that would traditionally be fixed terms, so that the teams can get a bit of stability and also optimise the use of the kind of near-me technology where it's appropriate to do so. In terms of a longer-term strategy, I'll be looking for some clear trajectories and movement over the next 3 to 6 months. And in terms of writing a strategic plan for mental health, again, probably within the same timescales, we would expect to see the fallout of that.
Thank you very much. Move on to the area of remobilisation and call Sandra White.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, everyone. And can I just thank all of the Health Service, Highlands and otherwise, for the great work that they are carrying out during this COVID pandemic. I've got three questions to ask, so I'll start off with the first one. Which areas have been most heavily impacted by COVID-19, and what impact does COVID-19 continue to have on service capacity?
Pam Dudek.
Okay, thank you. Well, I guess it's hard to pull out any individual area that hasn't been affected, but I think we would be remiss of us not to acknowledge the impact on elective care. So we had to step down significantly elective care during wave one, and I've had to pull back on it in this last 2 weeks, back to kind of urgent and move away from routine electives in Raigmore, which we hope will only be for the short term, but that has had an impact. So in wave one, there was a significant impact on how we were performing versus where we were at pre-COVID. And of course, on some of those markers, we were not in the best place anyway. So that was, CAMHS being one of them, that was an issue for us. And during remobilisation in the post the first wave, we actually did quite well in terms of remobilising those services through our plan and having a weekly surveillance of whether we were on plan with the targets we set, which were really around a plan and assumption of let's get to 60%, then 80% and head for 100% of pre-COVID performance, if you like. So that worked quite well, but it's obviously very concerning that we will have another knock-on effect, if you like, from the decisions we've had to take, you know, today, and we will have to monitor that really closely. We made good recovery in many areas. I can give you an example of the endoscopy, where we were sitting with a backlog of 600 people, and I can now say that we are seeing everybody within the 14-day window for that, so good progress there. More issues for us around orthopaedics, which of course for people, if we really think about why we're all here, and for those sitting waiting on hip replacements, for those with pain and because of musculoskeletal, etc., that's no consolation to them. But orthopaedics was an issue for us before and continues to be. Urology, with the subspecialties of bladder and prostatectomy, continue to be an issue for us in our cancer care, but we have got plans both with NHS Grampy and around working around Dr. Gray's, which are being initiated. And we also have work underway to have a centre that's a one-stop shop for diagnosis through to treatment, and that will give us further diagnostic capability going forward. So the work on the centre has commenced, and we will be looking to be again moving forward with that into the new financial year. So that's a big area of impact, and one that we are absolutely focused on and still looking at every week to ensure that we understand what's happening so that we can pick that up more quickly. We also did quite well on outpatients, but I think we also have to really think about the wider system in health and social care out in the community, the impact and the demand. So, you know, health and social care and community services never really stepped down. People still had to get their care at home. Care homes had to continue with really challenging situations, our community hospitals, our GP practices, our optometrists, pharmacies got busier. So all of our community health and social care teams have been impacted in terms of the level of demand and the complexity of which they've had to deal with. So I think there's nowhere untouched, but certainly for those waiting on elective surgery, the patients themselves will have really seen that effect, and perhaps learning disabilities, a family with people with learning disabilities or mental health problems, where the supports have been in a different way, or maybe not quite in the intense way that they've experienced it before. So lots of impacts, and we've definitely tried to maintain connections and be creative in what we do using virtual means to support people as well as we can.
Thank you, Kavina. Thank you for that. It is a difficult time for everyone, and obviously it can be very debilitating if you're not waiting on an operation. Do you have any timescale at all? Would you imagine any timescale? Well, I'm not necessarily saying get back to normal, but when the elective surgeries, etc., can start again. And have you looked at comparisons with other health boards in relation to your own, exactly how it impacts you and other health boards in that respect?
Yes, we have. And, you know, so in some ways, the fact that we didn't experience the infection rates in wave one in the end in the way that other health boards did mean that we could remobilise more quickly. And actually were able to, you know, achieve a reasonable recovery performance quite quickly, and that was commented on nationally in terms of our success with that. And the same will apply this time. We're reviewing it weekly at the point that we feel able to re-establish our routine care and that we can step up those services again, we will. And as I say, we will keep an eye on that on a weekly basis.
Thank you. Just moving on slightly, obviously the situation is just now, and we have a resurgence of COVID-19, obviously, and it could be even more, even right into September, October this year as well. Now, the impact of the resurgence that we've got at the moment, how has it impacted on the remobilisation plan, and is it anticipated to impact on the remobilisation plan?
Our revised remobilisation plan or annual operational plan, whatever you want to refer it, because it's one and the same now, we are underway with that in terms of being able to set out what our 2021-22 plan will be. And that will be, I guess, on the basis of living with COVID, but trying to do the best we can in the hope that our restrictions are effective and that we can a lot of the work that we need to do. So we expect that plan to set that out quite clearly. I think because of the remobilisation plan that we did back in August, we have a really good handle on where services are at. And this probably goes back to the fact that services have changed during this time. They've changed how they do their business. They've adapted and are much more adept at being creative in how they deliver their service. So, and also we've equipped a huge number of people, still not enough, but we've equipped a huge number of people with the right technology to be able to continue services. So whereas in wave one we had a bit of catch up to do and people had to adjust, those adjustments have been made. So mental health, for instance, the teams are teed up with the technology to be able to connect in that way. We've got virtual groups, all sorts of things going on there. So I think we know a lot more. We're probably more confident in what we're doing. We have really good surveillance of what we need to do and where our issues are. And as such, that allows us to be quite swift and agile in our decision making and also know very quickly where teams are struggling and what we need to do. We've also worked really well with the teams at the Scottish Government around the Access Collaborative and have continued to be successful in attracting seed funding to make changes within our services. And that, I think, was a reflection of the confidence that there was in us to remobilise the first time and to continue to make change.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Sorry, convener.
Professor Roberts.
I just wanted to say that although we're obviously contending with the COVID pandemic, that has not stopped other developments. And as recently as last week, we had the opening here in Broadford Hospital, where I'm based today, of a renal dialysis unit, which means that patients in Wester Ross and in Skye do not have to endure 10-hour sessions three times a week going through to Inverness, which is a long journey, and they very much welcome the advent of this service. And that's what we aim to do, to bring the services closer to the people.
Sandra White.
Thank you very much for that. And no doubt we will be seeing the revised plan also. This is my third and last question. And I note from papers that I have here, this is about implementation of the remobilisation plan and how it's been impacted by other issues. And I note from the paper in regards to its £25 million that you have to meet for waiting time standards, and there's still been no talks or meetings with the Scottish Government. That's something I think may impact on that. And also from an earlier answer to my question in regards to Home Farm, £1.3 million, which to service that, I take it that is a year, they may impact on that too. And there's other issues which are causing concern, particularly with Brexit, pharmacy workforce, estates, procurement, redesign and projects. So has the implementation of a remobilisation plan been impacted by any of the issues that I've mentioned, or which is in the paper that I have in front of me?
Sorry, I've got my computer's just gone off. Sorry about that. Well, I guess in terms of all of those areas, there's always that potential. The kind of Brexit aspect, we have been, and others might in the team, Dave Garden or others might want to say a bit more about that. And we obviously are working with the Scottish Government around that. And so far, we have managed to continue to operate and remobilise regardless, and I haven't had anything in particular raised in the last couple of weeks that has stopped us from remobilising. I think in terms of our capability and the work that I suppose the gap that needs to be filled in terms of recovery, as you say, in some areas it is significant, and that may have a cost to it. The challenge to us will be, so it is, how are we going to do that? And we have been encouraged to understand that from a national perspective, from a regional perspective, as well as a local perspective. So it's a bit like, you know, what is the optimum we can achieve locally, and how do we work with our partners on a regional basis to try and facilitate some of that recovery by coming together and using the expertise of multiple boards, and indeed what are the national resources that can support us, because we do use some of the independent sector national resources available to us, as well as other boards such as Grampian, to assist us at the moment in delivering on some of our targets. So we will continue in that vein to try and be as slick. I think the ask will be, and the leadership challenge will be, that we try and recover our position to the standards that are set out in TTG. And that will be challenging, but that's the ask of us. And hopefully our new revised remobilisation plan will give a confidence about how we're going to get there and what that will look like, and take account of some of those risks as you've set out.
Yeah. Thank you very much. And a brief supplementary from Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Just a quick supplementary question. There's obviously a lot of work that's happening in NHS Highland with COVID, with vaccination, with post-Stirrup organisational development issues. I'm interested in how all of this has been communicated to your to the staff, to the public, and then has there been a feedback on how the communication has been received? Because it's great that all this work has been done, but it's also good to make sure that's getting out to the people that are receptive to the changes.
Boyd Roberts.
We have just appointed a head of comms and engagement, and one of her tasks will be to bring up to date our strategy about comms, and you're right to point out the need for good communications internally and externally. As recently as this past week, we have had a joint communication with Highland Council externally about the COVID situation and our collaboration and urging people to abide by the rules, because we were concerned at the escalation in COVID numbers in Highland post Christmas, and happily we're now seeing a diminution in these numbers. Internally, we have various mechanisms which Pam will talk about in a moment to communicate on a regular basis. We have a weekly roundup, for instance, from our communications staff to all employees. And there was a feeling at one time that they were getting too many disparate forms of communication internally, and this was a way of bringing these together and possibly increasing the attention given to them by having it in one communication, form of communication. Can I just go back to the Sky Care Homes one as well, and the issue that Ms. White raised there. Going forward, we see the care home in Portree Home Farm being part of the redesign of services in the north of Skye. That's an ongoing initiative, and again points to the fact that the activity goes on as normal, even though we have the COVID pandemic upon us. Sir Lewis Ritchie has been reviewing progress on the Skye, Lochalsh and South West Ross out of hours and other services provision, and he reported to us towards the end of October that he was very satisfied with the progress that we were making there, and with the consultation with the community and the collaboration and co-production with the community. And I see that as vital to the health of the Highlands going forward, that we as a board co-produce with communities, that we collaborate with councils and work together to get the best solutions for the people of the Highlands, whether it be in Lochaber, where we are also engaged in our redesign project, or in Caithness, where we have another redesign project, or in Skye, or wherever throughout the area. So yes, communications is vital, and I think I would say that there's work to do in that space, and maybe ask Pam to say a little bit more about how we're addressing the communications issue.
Pam Dudek.
Thank you. Really, just expanding then on what Boyd said, we absolutely know there's more we can do, and that we want to really improve significantly on how we communicate and how accessible we are as a board and as an exec team across all our services. So we have got quite a number of things in place, but also some other things starting to come into being. So we have things like our weekly bulletin. So we've got the weekly roundup, but we also have what's known as the silver bulletin, which really captures all the COVID information that staff will need. And we also do videos from the gold meeting when it happens to really round up what's been happening in the week in gold, so that people can have some visibility of that too, and try and again get out key messages. So internally, there's a number of mechanisms that we're using to communicate, and we are sense checking that with staff all the time to see if that's working for them. And as you can imagine, some people find it really useful, some people don't like certain ways of communication, and so therefore we need to have a range that fit with the differences that of people. I think the communication and joined up communication with councils offers us a lot in terms of really reaching out to communities and using some of the mechanisms that they've already got established through schools, etc., to using some of those pipelines to get our messages out. Where we to trial a weekly column in one of the local papers in North Highland, and I've suggested that might be something that would be good to try out in Argyll and Bute as well, which again might get us out into communities and help people see what we're doing, make that more visible. I suppose cultivating our relationship with the press too, in a way that allows us to interact positively for the good of being open, transparent and people seeing that. And I also hope that our MSP MP briefings and our elected members briefings are going to make a difference. So really strengthening the connections and putting ourselves out there. And Tim has done a huge amount, as you can imagine, in recent months around COVID as the Director of Public Health, with councils, with messages out to communities and internally as well, and has featured on many videos. So those are a flavour of some of the things that we're doing.
Thank you very much. There are two remaining areas where members have questions. However, time does march on, and so I would ask David Stewart and Donald Cameron in turn simply to ask a single question and then ask the board witnesses to respond to that question, and if there's any further required around it, then we will pursue that after the meeting. David Stewart.
My question has been covered by previous answers, so I'll put the back to you, convener.
Thank you very much. Donald Cameron.
Thank you, convener. Could I just ask, how is NHS Highland ensuring that isolated people are getting the help and support they need during the current lockdown, given the issues around loneliness that we all know so well?
Pam Dudek.
Okay, so I will talk on both staff and the general public. So I guess with staff, we know who they are and we know who may be isolating, so we would use our mechanisms of line management to stay in touch with people and also reinforce the ways in which they can get in touch should they feel the need for further support or if they are distressed or are struggling. In fact, in looking at working practice and home working, we've been very clear that we obviously want people to home work, but a risk assessment needs to happen in terms of whether that works okay for people and whether you know, that we need to, in certain circumstances, allow safe working practice by coming to work, because for everybody home working is not a good thing. So from a staff perspective, that's probably more straightforward. From a community perspective, we really rely, I guess, on those people who are already in touch with us as services, right out into primary care and community care. We know who they are, and local GP practices will know who, particularly in the rural areas, who may be vulnerable, and that we would reach out to them or at the very least connect them with other community supports where possible, or virtual means. I think in terms of people that we don't know, we really need to encourage them, and perhaps there is a question about a stronger message there, to seek help. And I do think this does sit back with what's the community planning response that we can do around this. How do we, as partners with local communities, understand the breadth of that? Because local communities have already shown huge responses to this pandemic in terms of looking after their own and looking after their communities. So there are supports locally for that. So again, us just trying to be very linked in with that is what we've been trying to do.
Thank you very much. And can I thank Boyd Robertson and all of his colleagues who have given evidence to us today. That's been a very comprehensive session. As I mentioned, there are one or two areas where our witnesses have offered to come back to us with further information or where there have been numbers that we've asked for that you've not been able to provide immediately. We look forward to receiving those from you today in due course, and we'll write to you after today's meeting. In addition, there are areas, I think we've explored areas fairly thoroughly, but if there are further questions we need to ask in support of the questions we asked today, we will write to you about those promptly as well. As I say, many thanks for your evidence and for your comprehensive answers, and we will consider our next steps accordingly. Thank you very much. We will now move on to the second item on our agenda, which is consideration of a provisional UK common framework on food and feed safety and hygiene. Common frameworks are being developed to ensure that rules and regulations in certain policy areas remain consistent across the UK following exit from the EU, and our role is to scrutinise those common frameworks which fall within this committee's remit. We have our role to influence the content and monitor the application of such frameworks, and also to act as a conduit between stakeholders and the Scottish Government. The committee received a letter from the Scottish Government sharing the provisional UK common framework on food and feed safety and hygiene. The letter requests that we provide our commentary on that, and in order to do so, we are taking evidence today from stakeholders, and next week we will hear directly from the Minister for Public Health and Sport. But for today, I welcome to the committee once again Professor Paul Haggerty, Deputy Director of the Rowett Institute of Nutrition and Health at the University of Aberdeen, representing Safari, and David Thompson, Chief Executive Officer, Food and Drink Federation, Scotland. Thank you for joining us today. We very much appreciated your input at a previous consideration of another common framework, and very much value the evidence you provided in relation to this one too. And if I can start with the evidence provided by Paul Haggerty on this specific framework, and simply to say to David Thompson on these that if you wish to come in on these specific questions, then please simply indicate with an R in the chat box, and likewise for Paul Haggerty, if there's a question that's put to David Thompson that you would like to comment on, then draw my attention to that with an R in the chat box in the same way. Paul Haggerty mentioned a range of organisations which should be involved in developing this framework. And I guess the first question is whether you, either of our witnesses indeed, has been asked directly to contribute to the development of this particular framework, following your evidence, the last one. Paul Haggerty.
I can confirm that I have not been involved in the consultation.
David Thompson.
And firstly, apologies for not providing a written contribution this time, unfortunately. We've been a little pressed over the past few weeks, as you can perhaps imagine. We were involved in some way, as we have been in the previous common framework that we were talking about. We were invited to a stakeholder day on the 9th of October and had some additional information provided to us, and that was a across the UK stakeholder day run by both Food Standards Scotland and the Food Standards Agency. Prior to that, obviously, we've observed, as I think was set out in the Minister's letter, that it has been discussed in the Food Standards Scotland board meetings over the course of the past few years. Our ability to contribute has obviously been limited because even on the 9th of October, it was a previous version of the Common Framework. We discussed at length our concerns about the interaction of the Common Framework and the then Internal Market Bill at the last meeting that we had. Obviously, we've not had much opportunity to discuss with members, and even at the stakeholder day, there was obviously very limited time to provide contributions. So we have been involved, and we have been part of a stakeholder day, but not heavily involved.
Thank you very much. And in that respect, we seem to be in a similar place to the previous framework, where some people are engaged and others not. Can I come back to Paul Haggerty in relation to your written evidence? One of the things you said was that the mechanisms in relation to food and feed safety regulation and enforcement have developed organically over decades. They work well, but they are enormously complicated, and it is possible that the UK may fail to maintain those standards inadvertently by failing to appreciate the full complexity of the process. I wonder, Paul Haggerty, if you could comment on that, and if you could also suggest how such an inadvertent failure may be avoided. Paul Haggerty.
Thank you, convener. The whole regulatory framework is extremely complicated. It covers dietary requirements, novel foods, food safety, toxicology, etc. So all of those fields have an input into the decisions about foods. And it's a case of multiple jeopardy, if you like, because you have to meet all of the requirements for a particular food or feed or foodstuff. And it's a very complicated setup currently. It spans the information flows cover different countries and committees in different countries. And the documentation that was provided, the framework is actually provides a pretty good summary of the situation. Having worked within that to some extent through scientific advisory committees on nutrition, novel foods, toxicity, I can see from that perspective how complicated it is, and I just wonder, in a document like this, where you are not able to fully summarize the all of the linkages, it was really not possible to say whether it was fully covered there. And one thing I would suggest is, in terms of the consultation, there were a large number of groups consulted there. Whether the EU and EFSA would be worth involving in the consultation to see whether they would consider that anything had been missed. I think they would be extremely helpful, and even now some of the committee members on those panels are from the UK, and that would be a suggestion.
That's a very interesting suggestion indeed. Can I just, before I bring in Dave Thompson on this question, can I just check, Paul Haggerty, in relation to your answer to the first question and not being involved in the framework? I know that, as well as speaking here today from your position at the Rowett, you're also speaking in relation to food and agriculture research institutes across Scotland. Would it be true to say that neither you nor your colleagues in these research institutes have been consulted on the food and feed safety hygiene and hygiene framework?
Well, we have not at the Rowett Institute, and as far as I'm aware, the Safari institutes have not been directly consulted in this. They may have had invitations to the open sessions that FSS very helpfully arranged, but I'm not aware of any formal request to us.
Okay, thank you very much. And David Thompson.
Yeah, it was just really to underscore what Professor Haggerty has just said. This is a very complicated area of regulation. It covers a lot of different types of issue, but it also underpins production, distribution and sale of food, drink and feed across the UK. So it's of critical importance, I think, to have this type of common framework that allows for it to be as smooth as possible for businesses. But as Professor Haggerty says, whether it's covered everything is very difficult to judge at the moment. And I would agree with his suggestion around consulting with the European Union institutions and those involved in it, not least to learn out, where it could be better.
Thank you. And a call on Brian Whittle.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Professor Haggerty, you did state in your written evidence that you don't feel the common framework is fit for purpose. Although you describe the overall system as being well, but there are fundamental logistical inconsistencies at the heart of the proposed arrangement that will undermine that implementation. So can I ask you, Professor Haggerty, to maybe expand on those concerns that you've set out in your written evidence, that the common framework's not fit for purpose, and perhaps expand on why this is the case and what may need to change?
Paul Haggerty.
Thank you, convener and questioner. yes, the I have to say, first of all, that FSA and FSS were in an unenviable position here. This is a really complicated area, and they've done as much as they can to address concerns around it and produce something as simple as possible. I guess my concern is around the Northern Ireland question, and it's pretty clear in the framework that Ireland has to stick with the current EU framework, and that's not just static, it changes almost daily in terms of the there's a big volume of regulatory considerations that go through Europe, so that's a constantly moving situation. And currently there is alignment between the UK and Northern Ireland, but if Northern Ireland is going with has to continue with the European position, then basically you're going to have the four nations at the table, and Northern Ireland will essentially be representing the EU in discussions around how to deal with regulation. And it's very difficult to see how that could operate in practice and be consistent with the aspiration to maintain consistency across the UK. I'm sure there'll be some minor changes that it will be possible to accommodate, but I can imagine that within a reasonably short period of time, there will be issues that come up, that there may be disagreements between the UK and the EU in terms of how they want to proceed, and that would put Northern Ireland in a very difficult position.
David Thompson.
Just to build on the Northern Ireland issue, we would agree with Professor Haggerty. While the framework does set out how it will work, how that works in the context of the EU's risk analysis procedures for food and feed is unclear. And I would also like to highlight another issue, which is when you are seeking license to put new and novel foods on the market, you would then need to go through two processes, one for Great Britain and one for Northern Ireland, which might make the UK market less attractive to businesses who want to innovate.
Thank you very much. And I call on Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to our panel. I'm interested in how the impact of the framework will work on internal trade and on exports. And perhaps this is a question for David Thompson. It's whether the witnesses, whether either of you have the opportunity to consider how the UK-EU trade arrangement may influence the operability of the framework in regard to exports from Great Britain to Northern Ireland and then markets further to the European Union. I know, Professor Haggerty, you just spoke about Northern Ireland, but in the documents that we have in front of us, there is risk management decisions at a national level in areas where EU legislation permits different approaches, such as raw drinking milk. And I know that, like, currently an example would be, we've got a local factory near Newton Stewart that processes milk and yogurt and protein-based yogurts, but the product goes back and forward to Northern Ireland, but then from Northern Ireland to the Republic of Ireland. And so this is an issue that might have some conflicts when we look at the operability of this framework. Is that a concern that you might have?
David Thompson.
So this is a very, very complicated picture, as you've set out there, and its interaction with the current terms of the EU-UK trade deal are probably still to be seen. We already know that there are some issues already between trade between the UK, Northern Ireland, and the Republic of Ireland caused by the current set of legislation and the terms of the trade deal. So trying to divorce those is quite difficult at the moment. What I would say is that the UK needs to be able to prove that its food is safe and it matches the level required for export into Europe. So we need a strong and robust system that allows us to do that. I hope the common framework facilitates that. If you are exporting into Europe, you will need to match European legislation in any case, and for it need to be, and that would quite often need to be validated within the UK by the UK's health system and food safety system. So it is highly likely, in particular as legislation develops and there are potential differences between UK legislation and European legislation, that you know, the need for assurance that the EU will require will get more stringent potentially. So no necessarily initial impact that we could divorce here from the current ructions that we're seeing about the trade deal. But as legislation begins to differentiate itself in the United Kingdom, or in Great Britain at least, sorry, then it may be an issue as we move forward. But the bottom line for any company exporting to Europe is it needs to match the European legislation. So it's just how that's validated on a country-to-country basis is the key issue, I think.
Emma Harper.
Okay. Thank you, David, for that answer. It's obviously is very complex, as you've highlighted, and you know, I have food and feed safety concerns as we move on with trade deals and other produce that's maybe coming into the country. But I'm also wondering how we're going to have to be able to monitor this, and I've raised this previously as well, that all of these regulatory processes are going to need to be monitored. So we're going to have to look at what's happening in the EU and look at all these mechanisms in detail and in the framework. So perhaps, Professor Haggerty, do we have the ability to monitor the framework? How can we do that in a timely and realistic way? And who should be monitoring this the process as this moves forward?
Paul Haggerty.
Thank you. The current situation is that the scientific expertise to do this kind of work is definitely in the UK. The UK already makes a major contribution to EU considerations in this area anyway. So that would definitely be possible to do. But it is extremely difficult to do it, and I would imagine that it would be something like a team of people. I don't know how big, but it would be they would have to operate on an administrative level and basically monitor all the regulation in real time that as it changes in Europe, and somehow put in place a dissemination mechanism to either let producers and also consumers know about those changes and how they would cope with them, or introduce them into UK law reasonably quickly. So it would be, because of the sheer volume of regulation and the rate of change in Europe, I would imagine this would have to be constant monitoring.
Emma Harper.
Okay, thanks for that answer. And, you know, looking at the whole constant monitoring, constant, I guess, the intensive processes, the whole complexity around it. Do you have concerns about the operability or interoperability for this framework? You've mentioned Northern Ireland already, but is there going to be continued challenges in how the UK makes this common framework work with Northern Ireland?
Paul Haggerty.
Well, the Northern Ireland situation is very complicated for the reasons I just set out. I mean, basically, it will be they will be following the European situation, and actually, there may be an opportunity there because as regulation comes out of Europe and is taken up in Northern Ireland, there could be a communication linked to the rest of the UK to say that this has happened, this is what we're changing, and you're aware of it now, and you can make a decision on whether you want to go with this or whether you want to disengage from this particular regulation. So actually, that might be an opportunity.
Thank you
very much. And can I go back to Brian Whittle, I think, at a supplementary on your earlier question. Brian Whittle.
I was just really around the issue of looking at what has to change. How do we, us as a committee, we will obviously be developing our recommendations. From your perspective, what needs to change around that operability of the framework to make it more palatable?
Paul Haggerty.
I think that the Northern Ireland situation is just a logical problem there. There are two aspirations which will be to some extent incompatible. So that's the desire to hold Northern Ireland within a UK context, and the fact that Northern Ireland also has to work with the European legislation. So that's a problem. And to be honest, I really don't know how you fix that one. It may be that there would be many advantages, and David Thompson would know more about this than I do, about maintaining similar regulatory framework to Europe, and certainly in terms of export and import. So the extent to which you can track the two regulatory systems, then that's the extent to which the framework will be successful.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. David Tollins.
Thank you, Convener. How will what is now the Internal Market Act impact on how the framework will operate?
David Thompson.
Thanks for the question. I was anticipating it. We are now in a position where the Internal Market Act sets out a way for common frameworks to be incorporated. So that is new since the last time that we spoke, when the Act was just a bill. So that's an interesting development, and it means that this common framework could potentially be exempt from the terms of the Internal Market Act. What we don't have is an agreement that this common framework will be exempt from the terms of the Internal Market Act. And then, as we've already talked at length, this is a very complex set of regulations that cover a vast range of issues in food and feed. And so you may end up with where the common framework is exempt from the Internal Market Act's principles. You may end up with a set of issues where each government is looking at this and coming up with different solutions. Now, that's not the point of the Common Framework. It's not the point of the Internal Market Act. So I would hope that the new provision in the Internal Market Act makes it much clearer how the Common Framework integrates, and therefore makes it much clearer how this particular Common Framework will work.
Thank you very much. David Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I have a question around the pre-market approval and reauthorisation. I've looked at the answer from the Minister of the 30th of November, but are you reassured that the process or the processes for business to apply for pre-market approval and reauthorisations for both the GB market, such as the Novel Foods, and the Northern Ireland market are both clear enough and in place right now?
David Thompson.
So, as I mentioned earlier, we are concerned but it's an inevitability, I think, of the Northern Ireland Protocol, that there are a different set of pre-market access issues and procedures for Northern Ireland than there are from the rest of the UK. Other than that, they currently, as far as we understand, they mirror the European processes. So from our perspective, at the moment that seems okay. But as I said, the danger of separating off the Northern Ireland market from the rest of the GB, making the GB system, the UK system, more complicated, means that there might be an issue of people not applying for this kind of thing within the UK, and therefore you might lose some of the food innovation that we are rightly known for.
Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Convener. This is a question really for Professor Haggerty. Professor Haggerty, in your written evidence, you state that the framework generally demonstrates an understanding of the overall competencies that will have to be taken on by the UK, but that these are mostly presented as lists, and that it's unclear that whether the kind of complex nature of the linkages, I think is a word you use, between these processes has been fully appreciated. Can you expand on the risks that approach may present, please?
Paul Haggerty.
Thank you for that question. The risk is that, to go back to what was done in the framework, I think it was the information that's in there is as good as it can be. The problem is that to fully represent the system would require a fairly substantial document with diagrams about interactions about various processes. So, for example, on the Novel Foods Committee, there is representation on there from the Advisory Committee on Nutrition. On the Advisory Committee on Nutrition, they have access to committees on toxicity, etc. So when they are dealing with particular issues, then they can call on dynamically, if you like, lots of different processes and expertise. And it may be that is fully appreciated in the document, in the way it's been looked at by FSA and FSS. But really, the documentation is not detailed enough to be able to say whether that is fully the case.
Thank you very much. Sandra White.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, gentlemen. I wanted to ask one particular question, maybe a follow-up on the dispute resolution mechanism. Now, there's some interesting comments that came out from the House of Lords Committee. And one of the comments which struck me mentions the framework dispute resolution process is not triggered automatically. It can only be triggered where either officials or ministers in any nation of the UK wish to object to the approaches recommended in one or more of the Great Britain nations. Now, taking that comment and then looking now at the fact that the UK Westminster government are looking at a consultation and the use of gene-edited crops and livestock in England. And now we're looking at a pesticide which kills bees, basically banned in the EU, but can now be used in the UK, i.e. under sugar beet, which is now law. I just wonder on your thoughts how the framework dispute resolution would work in these instances when obviously you get GM crops, et cetera, which abandoned Scotland, and also the fact that, and it's very interesting, the Professor mentioned EFSA. I mean, the EU has the most stringent regulations in the world, and EFSA is everything subjected to really extensive case-by-case science-based evidence. So I wonder how that would work, in your opinion, in regards to if Scotland, for instance, or even Northern Ireland, which obviously is under the EU regulation, but Wales as well, how that would work under the dispute resolution.
Paul Haggerty.
That's a very good question, and I guess it deserves a very good answer. The first thing is that if these things are changed, like genetically modified organisms, neonicotinoid pesticides, etc. You would have to go back to the committees in the UK who have already, I think, largely agreed or have agreed with the European situation. So those committees would have to look at those things again. How you the concept about triggering an issue depends, I guess. I don't know what the arrangements are for monitoring this. Obviously, ministers can do it or officials. It would be up to them to monitor what's coming out of the committees and decisions, etc. But the kind of things that you're talking about are actually probably risk management rather than risk assessment. They're about interpretation of evidence and societal choices, if you like. And that is, in fact, one of the difficulties with the dispute resolution process, because they, in the documentation and the framework, they emphasize the looking at the objective evidence. And when you're dealing with these kind of societal issues and value judgments, then it would be very difficult to base it on that kind of objective evidence. So I guess in reading through the documentation, I was less relaxed about whether they could actually or whether the resolution mechanism would work in all cases. So I don't know if that answers your question.
It gives me more questions, I think. Sorry, thank you, Kavina. I think it gives me more questions, but you did answer the particular part about the interpretation of evidence and the management. But there's no answer to what risks this presents if it is allowed to go ahead. So is that where your idea or your comment in regard to speak to the EU and EFSA as well, that perhaps we could raise these questions with them as a committee?
Thank you, convener. They have already made decisions in these areas, and they will continue to do so. I guess the UK would have the choice as to whether to stick with those, that interpretation of the scientific evidence, or whether to change its interpretation. And to some extent, this is where you come across the risk assessment, risk management problem. Many of the differences between countries in terms of what they do in things like GMO is to do with their interpretation of the quality of the evidence, the available evidence, etc. So the US, for example, looks at pretty much the same evidence base and comes to the conclusion that GMO, from their point of view, is adequately safe for them to proceed with it. Europe doesn't do that currently. And I guess the UK would be in a position where it could choose where to go with this.
David Thompson, come in.
Yes, I'll bring you back after we've heard from David Thompson. David Thompson.
Thank you, convener.
Okay, thank you, convener. So I'm really glad Paul got that question first. The point that he's raising, just it's the risk management that is really the issue. What decisions are taken by politicians, governments, and by civil servants based on the evidence? And as Paul says, the evidence in general tends to be, you know, community accepted scientific evidence across the whole of the world. It's then what you do with it. And I think it's in that risk management bit that it's much, much harder to see where how there is an easy way out of the difficulties in terms of differentiation of response to those risks. So which will be informed by society, by stakeholders, both in industry and in the broader third sector and others, and by public opinion. And that's really, I think, where the risk management process and the dispute resolution process will come into conflict. It's easy to see it written down and say that all makes sense, but actually you're talking about very emotive and difficult issues. And I think we've all to see how this is going to work in any of the common frameworks, I think.
Just a small one, whether it's could get an answer or it's a comment, or maybe it's for the Scottish Government. In the House of Lords committee, as I read out at first, it mentions the dispute resolution process, but it also goes on to say it can only be triggered where officials and ministers in any nation of the UK, any nation, not just England, who have already said that this can come into England. And that's the point I'm trying to make. What would we be able to do under the Scottish Parliament or basically Scottish Government to stop this type of thing coming into our country? Wales may do the same, Northern Ireland may do the same. And that's where I find the difficulty trying to get my head around that. I don't know if I'll get any answers or...
No, but we can ask the question. Paul Haggerty.
thank you for that question too. These are all based on scientific questions. So you must go back to the scientific evidence. So if one country wanted to proceed with this, then there are two levels that you'd have to do this. You'd have to go back to the scientific evidence and you would say, let's look at this. And does everybody agree on this? Now, the devolved nations could just take it as read because they don't have their own subcommittees to look at what the central committees are doing. So they have the opportunity to just take it as read. And I think the quality of scientific advice in the UK is very high. And I think it would be reasonable to accept that. But the real decision will again be at the level of risk management, societal choices. Although there, just to add another complication, there is a particular area that you have to keep in mind with GMO in that if one sector or one food wants to go with it, then it could have an effect on other sectors and their ability to sell their products. So it these things can be very complicated. So I guess there are three levels on which the complication operates.
Thank you very much. I don't know if David Thompson wants to add anything on that one.
I can do it. I suppose the interesting thing here from our perspective is how this interacts, I'm afraid, again, with the Internal Market Act and the Common Framework. So this Common Framework does cover some elements of GMO. If the Internal Market Act was in place and this Common Framework wasn't exempted from it on GMO, then that would mean that while Scotland's production methods could ban GMO, for example, then the sale of GMO goods couldn't be banned in Scotland. However, if the Common Framework and the GMO element was included in the exemptions from the Internal Market Act, it really depends on what's decided. But you could argue that there's a position there where both sale of GMO goods and production could be banned. So it's not really an issue of the Common Framework, it's how the Common Framework interacts with that regulation.
That's very helpful.
Thank you for that.
Thank you very much. And finally, I call on George Adam.
Thank you very much, convener. I've just got one question, and this committee, the Health and Sport Committee, obviously believes that it's got a role when it comes to the common frameworks and how things move forward. But I'd like to ask both of you, what further role would be helpful to the industry and to consumers for the Parliament to perform during all this? And what in particular should the Parliament be tracking as this framework evolves?
Start with David Thompson.
So we would agree the Scottish Parliament has a fundamental role, this committee has a fundamental role in tracking what's a complex area of regulation. We would agree that actually lots of these issues need more debate rather than less debate as we move forward, and we would welcome the opportunity to continue to contribute in this manner to support our members. I think the other element is the proposed creation of the Office of the Internal Market, which will look at the Internal Market Bill and its operation. That must, I would imagine, look at where there is friction between common frameworks and the Internal Market Act's operations. So again, that would be another area where either this committee or another committee of the Scottish Parliament would be welcome in looking at how well the Office of the Internal Market is actually delivering for businesses in Scotland.
Thank you very much. Paul Haggerty.
Thank you for that, that also very complicated question. I guess I would argue that the scientific arena is pretty well covered by FSA and FSS. I think they can oversee that very well. But the as we've discussed, most of the areas, the difficulties, etc., will come in terms of the risk management and the societal decisions, and obviously that is an area where the Parliament and your committee would be performing a very important role. So watching over all of those things and the decisions, and I'm absolutely sure that within a short period of time you will have some issues to consider.
Thank you very much. I suspect you're right about that point, and no doubt that will be further food for thought for this committee and successor committees going forward in dealing with all these areas. Can I thank both Paul Haggerty and David Thompson once again for very valuable and insightful contributions, for your evidence to assist the committee. We will hear from the Minister in a week's time, and no doubt many of the questions that we've addressed with yourselves will be addressed to the Minister at that time. Thank you very much. The committee will now move into private session. We will resume at 5:12 on a different platform, but for the moment, I now suspend this meeting. Thank you.